Doing that. Okay, you're on.
All right. Stamina. Describing Friday's events on the New York Stock Exchange, he used the word meltdown. On occasion, shame has been an element of his demeanor. He felt desire for a woman, yet desires no woman. The sound of a familiar voice speaking an unknown language. The sound of an airplane crossing overhead and the sight of dust on a table he inherited from his Polish grandmother. She told him that in the city where she lives, the man who most reminds her of her father is a homosexual chef raised in Hungary. He said, "I do not know the frequency of need." In the posture assumed while washing dishes at a low sink. When the train stops, when the movie ends, when the thunder ceases. Thinking, he laughs out loud. An algorithm for intuition, a pixel for compassion. At the semiconductor fab, 75 employees work rotating shifts. At the party where he stayed too long, stayed past the other guests leaving, stayed beyond the hosts going to bed, stayed until the sun rose and Con Ed workers in the street below began drilling to uncover power mains. At the party, he thought of an ex-girlfriend and felt remorse. Hearing rain on the window, he adjusts his eyes to the dim light. Elegance and eloquence and abundance and certainty. The organizing principle of communication is repetitive motive. This is called the most impressive buildings in Europe are cathedrals and in America, banks. A coincidence of manners surrounds the fisted work, glum offices, and current rate of exchange. In the latitude and longitude of exploitation, feeble frames with lingering names, ache, and incomplete carnality greet their mornings with hostility. Despair is the empty emotion. When cramped beds, some drizzling sunlight, the speaking clock, your yawning mind. Too often, liberty looks like cowardice. Freedom comes unintentionally when the mind rises to meet the chosen occupation necessary for survival. There is no sudden awakening. There is no greatness in death when a martyr longs for his cross.
Whew.
Okay. Something. While watching a new sitcom on TV, a cynical expression passes over the features of the man's face. At that very moment, his girlfriend sends him a loving look, then flinches when she sees the utter hatefulness in his eyes. Still childless in her late 30s, she walks beside him through midnight streets, a bewildered Cassandra, her concentration fixed as if she is occupied with filling some inner cavity. Their sex is often without intercourse. She simply loves to be near him, to touch his cock, to gaze with awe and fear on the mystery of him so different than herself.
Ooh. Yeah.
This is called Nocturne. Nocturne.
Yeah.
Only in the greatest need of peace can a soul resist those whose motives lack beauty. Our island is punished by winter. Beneath the snowfall we linger, our tongues buried in silence. There's a kind of suffering that requires a stage, a play, a monotonous soliloquy about extravagant vices. Finally, in Act 5, Scene 1, truth enters disguised as manipulation. In the absence of contentment, this world cannot continue, and the end will not be some great crash or some great class, but a mute isolation of spirit. To heal ourselves, we will lick another woundless. Slumber in darkness until a dream opens your eyes. Your bed was covered with shame once, but now it is quilted with a passion for empathy.
Yeah.
I'll just read two more. In my dream, you are both the child with the persistent cough and the man shaking aspirin from a bottle. I am the rapid change of scenery. Last month, I managed to get some work done, the cyclopean eye of my computer staring into me. Then you caught a cold and I slipped into ennui. In the corner of your kitchen where you hung a line from Elliot, typed and framed. Quietly, your father's phrase. a favorite CD, inherited revelation. Our trip to the ocean, Spring Lake on the Jersey Shore, never happened. At my apartment, I have color-coded maps and brochures for bed and breakfast, and one night while watching TV, I spread them out on the floor and imagined salt-stained work boots, icy confessions, and ending night. In my memory, you are the thief crouched low at a lock and an awakening hunger before dawn. In my posture, you are possible defeat. In my thoughts, you are recurring gesture and unspoken decision. In my attitude, you are contemplative and brief. You are never coming back. You are the unbidden breeze. I am the rapid change of scenery.
Yeah.
All right, my final one, and we're done. What remains is not your face or your hands, the width of your cock, the strength of your glance or timbre of your voice, but a tempo of being I could not invent.
Wow, that was really good. That was an incredible one, Debbie.